And they also, if they abide not still in unbelief, shall be grafted in, for God is able to graft them in again.
Shalom, everyone. Welcome to Grafted In. I am Bonnie with United in Yeshua here in Deloge, Missouri. I have with me
Jerry Coulter. I'm the pastor at Grace Family Outreach Church in Park Hills.
Hi, I'm Sharon Cluck with Mind the Messiah Ministries of Farmington, Missouri, and we have a Sabbath Day Fellowship.
Okay, we'd like to welcome our listeners. This is Grafted In. We are a weekly broadcast that is dedicated to helping all of us Christians determine what we are actually grafted into, the roots of our faith. So we have been in a series of the feasts of God from the Old Testament right now. These are going to be airing as those feasts come about, and so many people have been starting to celebrate them and have questions about them. So as we do this broadcast, if you have any questions, you can send us an email at graftedin@myyahoo.com. Or you could be watching on YouTube, or you may be listening on the radio. If you're listening on the radio, you can rewatch them on our YouTube channel, which is Grafted In. And it is a blue circle with a tree with roots that says Grafted In. And then you can make comments or ask questions on the YouTube videos, and we'll try to reply to those. I did say the email address already. I said that first. So if you get on YouTube, please subscribe, like, and share. Help us get the word out there. God's feasts are amazing, and just serving the Lord is amazing. So we're not going to spend a lot of time introducing. This is like our 17th broadcast. So I think by now those that are watching are getting used to us. So we're just going to start with a quick prayer, and then we're going to jump right in where we left off last week. So, Jerry, you want to pray for us?
Yes, Father, we thank you so much for this privilege and wonderful opportunity to share your word, to share the truth on Grafted In, what it means, and get the word out to your people. We thank you. We believe that this information today is going to be so very helpful to your people, the listeners and the viewers. So we just thank you and praise you that you have chosen us and that you have chosen the ones who are tuning in.
Yes.
In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Okay, so we are on the third part of the introduction of God's feast, and we are on a part we're calling, Were the Sabbath and the Feast Fulfilled in Christ? Or did the apostles actually teach that that it's not necessary, or that we don't need to do the feasts? So we're just going to start. Sharon, you want to go ahead and start with our study?
It says, but didn't the apostles teach that it's okay to not keep the Sabbath and the feast? Let's look. Some have claimed that the Sabbath and the feast were fulfilled in Christ, which according to them means that we didn't have to keep these anymore. At least not in the literal sense that the Bible teaches. It's in believing that Yeshua brought the Sabbath and the feast to a higher meaning in the New Covenant, which somehow annuls their practical application. Let's take a look at the New Testament passages that are commonly used to support this theory. So we're first going to look at Matthew 12, 1 and 2. At that time, Jesus went through the grain field on the Sabbath. His disciples were hungry, and they began to pluck heads of the grain and to eat. But when the Pharisees saw it, they said to him, "Look, your disciples are doing what is not lawful to do on the Sabbath day." But did Yeshua condone his disciples breaking the Sabbath in this passage?
Let's talk about that.
Okay.
Let's just talk about it.
You go right ahead.
I don't believe that Jesus was condoning the disciples breaking the Sabbath on that day. I don't think that they did break the Sabbath by plucking weeds. That was the rabbi's interpretation of what was and was not work.
Mm-hmm.
on the Sabbath.
Exactly.
And yeah, they were hungry. They needed to eat.
So we run into this a lot with people who keep the feast and the Sabbath, because there's such a large variety or discrepancy about how people do. Some people are so into Hebraic customs that they won't even flip a light switch on a Sabbath day because that's seen as work.
I have a refrigerator that actually has a Sabbath mode.
Really?
That my refrigerator,
if I... religious refrigerator.
Yes! If I set my refrigerator for a Sabbath mode, every Saturday my refrigerator will not work. The lights will turn off, the freezer will quit making ice, and all that stuff. And we didn't know that, and it just didn't make ice right after we first got it. And it was like, what? And we're reading the paper. And I said, I'm sorry, but my refrigerator is a mechanical thing. You know, it doesn't need a break on Saturday. So that's how extreme Jewish tradition can get. And that's what was going on back then.
And that's why people would even buy homes close enough so they didn't go further than a Sabbath day journey.
Right.
And so if they live in a city, they had to be so many blocks from the synagogue because they couldn't go more than a Sabbath day journey. None of that stuff is in the scripture.
Exactly. And that's what I think Jesus was trying to point out on this Matthew 12:1-2 when he rebukes basically the religious leaders.
Mm-hmm. And they weren't even cooking this grain. They were grabbing the grain and eating it.
Because they were hungry.
Yeah, and they weren't harvesting. They weren't laboring for money. They weren't harvesting. They were simply eating a meal on a Sabbath day.
Exactly.
Because they were hungry.
Exactly.
They grabbed them some corn.
Right. It goes on and it says, first of all, as we've already seen, Yeshua completely affirms the validity of the Sabbath as part of the Torah in Matthew 5:17-20. Why would he condone his disciples breaking the Sabbath shortly after he affirmed it? We read Matthew 5:17-20 last week, but Jerry, you want to go ahead and read that again? Matthew 5.
Do not think that I came to destroy the law or the prophets. I did not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For assuredly, I say to you, till heaven and earth pass away, one jot or one tittle will by no means pass from the law till all is fulfilled. Whosoever therefore breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches men so shall be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does and reaches them, he shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I say to you that unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven.
You see, the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees was based on their interpretation of their works.
Religious.
And Jesus was saying, you know, one of our favorite scriptures is he says, all of these things are summed up into two, to love God and to love each other. It wouldn't be very loving to make your disciples starve.
That's
right. When they've been walking for a long way.
Today, I saw Jerry posted on Facebook that she was planning her sermon and that it was about not earning your way to heaven.
Exactly.
And that it was a free gift from God. It's grace. It's from God.
Yes.
And so I thought to myself, I wonder who she knows that is earning their way to heaven. I wonder who she's talking about me, because I don't run into people who think they're earning their way to heaven or working their way to heaven. But when you look at these scriptures, you can see that that's what they thought.
There's a lot of people that think they're working their way.
Right.
And sitting in the churches, hearing grace and hearing our message, still think, maybe subconsciously, but they're working their way. They have to work to please God, they think.
Yeah, no, I think our works is a result of our love for God.
That's what it's supposed to be.
Right. Yeah. Exactly.
We work because we love God.
Exactly.
So this verse in Matthew 12:1-2 was not Yeshua taking away
from the Sabbath. No.
He was simply saying that the dispute was about how to keep the Sabbath. It wasn't that the Sabbath went away. It was how to keep it.
And as far as he was concerned, he was honoring the Sabbath.
He was.
He wasn't doing anything to dishonor it.
Exactly.
That was their opinion.
So Matthew 12:7, which is where you were at, goes on. Yeshua proclaimed his disciples' innocence in Matthew 12:7 and rebuked the Pharisees for making the entire point of the Sabbath by their interpretations. So you want to read Matthew 7?
But if you had known what this means, I desire mercy and not sacrifice, you would not have condemned the guiltless.
Exactly.
Because they were guiltless as far as Jesus was concerned.
Exactly, because it wouldn't have been very merciful to make them starve. They were hungry. They had been walking for a long time. And that wasn't work. That wasn't work.
Right.
So, Sharon, you want to read our next scripture, Colossians 2, 16 through 17. Mm-hmm. And this is another scripture that people use to say that the laws have been taken away. So go ahead.
So this is Colossians 2, 16 and 17. Therefore, let no one pass judgment on you in questions of food or drink, or with regard to the festivals or the new moons or the Sabbath. They're just a shadow of things to come, but the substance belongs to Christ.
Exactly. So Jerry, read what our commentary has to say about it.
Is this passage saying that anyone who teaches obedience to the Sabbath and feasts is a judgment legalist who emphasizes the shadow over the substance? Who are these judgmental people that Paul is warning against? If we look earlier in the passage at Colossians 2:8, we see that Paul is warning the Colossian believers about all those who are trying to lead them astray through deception and human tradition. But the Sabbath and feasts are not human tradition. Moreover, these false teachings are said to be in opposition to the teaching of Messiah. But Messiah affirms and teaches the Sabbath and the feasts as part of the Torah. Indeed, Paul himself affirms the validity of the Sabbath and feasts as part of all Scripture in 2 Timothy 3:16. A more likely explanation is that these false teachers were judging the Colossian believers for how they kept the Sabbath and the feasts.
Because a lot of surprise people don't realize is that, especially in biblical times, in Colossians, there were all kinds of pagan beliefs. Just like now, we have pagan religions. And those different religions had their own feasts.
Yes.
And
yes.
they had their own yes. celebrations. So here we've got these people that are coming out of those pagan beliefs and celebrations. And they're trying to learn God's ways.
And they're coming into
some of their feasts. Some of their feasts and their celebrations were out-and-out orgies.
Yeah, we know. Yeah, let's not go into that.
Well, my point is that it was so drastically different. It wasn't anything that even looked the same. And that's why Paul can lay out for you. We're talking about something different. Don't be bringing your stuff in here. We leave our garbage behind.
You know, Sharon, you and I, we were talking earlier about Passover, which is going to be our next video next week. So be sure you tune in. We're going to touch on Passover. But we were talking about that earlier about Passover and unleavened bread and how leaven represents sin. And when I read that story and I realized they had to hurry up and leave and God didn't allow them time for their bread to leaven. And throughout scripture, leaven is referred to as sin. Mm-hmm. And so it was kind of a metaphor that God says, if you are going to leave this place that is filled with pagan beliefs and pagan gods, you are not taking any of that sin with you. So I am the bread of life and the leaven is going to, it's not going to happen.
Exactly.
It's absolutely not going to happen. So when they had to leave and they had to eat unleavened bread, it was a metaphor of leaving the sin behind. So that's what's going on here in this scripture in Colossians 2:16-17. They've got their friends telling them, you know, what do you mean you're not going to have it? Sharon said, you're not going to have an orgy? What's wrong with this God that you're worshiping? You know, people were really dogging them about these new practices that they were learning. And Paul is telling them, don't let anybody judge you by the way that you do the feast. And it's even the religious people, because the religious people came along and said, oh, wait a minute, these Gentiles are not doing this kosher. They're not doing it perfectly. But we just read that scripture. Jerry just read it, that when Jesus rebuked the religious leaders, he said, how did he word it, about that he looks at our heart. He wants us to worship him. He wants us, you know, it's how we do it from our heart. To me, that's what Jesus did when he came. He made clear God's laws, that it's not about what we do, but about how we do it and why we do it. You know, like you said, you go to church and you're sitting there and you think you're checking it off your list and you're trying to earn your way to heaven. God is not honoring that.
Exactly.
You know?
Right.
So it's not about what we do, yet it is about what we do. Are we not supposed to go to church? Are we not supposed to fellowship?
It tells us to fellowship. It's an outward demonstration of an inward love.
motive.
Exactly. Why we're doing it.
Exactly.
So these feasts and the Shabbat or Sabbath, for those of you that are listening for the first time, Shabbat is the Hebrew name for Sabbath, which is the seventh day. These feasts and Shabbat is all about why we're doing them, not just the fact that we're doing them. Okay, so it says the false teachers are telling the Colossians that unless they observe the commandments in strict adherence to their particular ways, they are not actually keeping the commandments at all and will therefore fall under judgment of God. Now that's the religious leaders, those of you that are Christians that grew up in church, we called these the Pharisees and the Sadducees. The Pharisees weren't very fair, you see, and the Sadducees were sad, you see.
Because they didn't believe in the resurrection.
It's the common Christian interpretation of these verses that Paul had taught the Colossian believers to disregard the Torah regulations of kosher foods and appointed times, and that the false teachers were trying to persuade them that these were necessary. But that interpretation neither fits the wider teaching of Paul nor the immediate context. The false teachers were suggesting that the Colossians were failing to observe the commandments as they had determined they should be observed, not that the Colossians had entirely neglected the commandments. It's important to note what Paul does not say. He doesn't say that the Sabbath and feast are now abolished or no longer literally applicable to the new covenant.
He went to every one of them.
Yeah, and he so did showed Jesus. Up
and and so did Jesus, yes, and so did all Jesus. The apostles. They were always talking about getting back to Jerusalem because the feast, one or the other of the feasts, were getting ready to happen.
Yes. Yeah, one of the girls in our fellowship, when we first started doing the feasts, she got so overwhelmed with trying to do them the Jewish way. And I told her, I says, you don't have to do them the Jewish way. You can do them God's way. And God's way is super simple. He says, my yoke is easy and my burden is light.
Yes.
We just kind of went through that because we're getting ready to have Feast of Trumpets at Jerry's church. And that's one of the easiest ones. You know, you remember the trumpet, you have a gathering, you blow the shofar. It's super easy. You know, you don't have to get a lot of legalism in it, and God didn't give us a lot of legalism for it. So, Sharon, you're holding your paper. Are you wanting to?
And when I first, my first feast that I had, I got back from Israel, and it was time for Passover. Mm-hmm. And so I did and I was trying to do it by the letter of the law of the book I had. And someone said to me that was used to doing these feasts, they said, you don't have to do, you know, you can use something else, something I didn't have that.
Right.
I wanted to have everything just perfect, but you can use other things. You don't have to use the exact things that are on the list.
But you know what is cool about that? I did the same thing, but I think that God saw your heart.
That's what it was.
And I believe that he saw mine. It's like I was so excited when I seen how amazing these feasts are and what they represent. So please tune in the next several weeks, because it is amazing what God has lined out in these feasts and what we learn from these feasts.
And what they point to.
And what they point to, yeah. Exactly. That I wanted it to be perfect, and I was like you. My family's Jewish, so I thought, oh, I've got to do it just like that. So my stepmom, when she comes, I don't have anything messed up. And then God just spoke to me and said, take a chill pill.
Amen. You know?
So we did a Seder, but we didn't do it perfect. We did it as best we could.
Part of this is that this has been the feast, and even the Sabbath have been taken out of our culture. So when we see them, when we have aha moments in the scripture, and we go, oh, I see that. That's in the scripture. Nobody taught me that. Well, now we're trying to move back into doing things God, doing Bible things, Bible ways. And when we start to do that, we don't have a clue where to start. So we just go overboard. The pendulum always swings. You're going, you're out way out here, and you come right back here. And then at some point, you come down in the center, and it becomes part of your life. It becomes easy. So hard. But when we begin this stuff, we just go overboard. That's so typical of this. People will pick up a Haggadah and they want to do everything exactly like the Jewish people do. Yes. We're not trying to be Jewish.
For those of you listening, a Haggadah is a guidebook for the Jewish people. So,
got the lamb. I mean, I saw it till I got the lamb.
Well, you just get the lamb. The lamb is a good thing.
The lamb.
But, I mean, if you did a roast, God's not going to strike
exactly.
you. Exactly. And the whole point is Jesus, Yeshua, the whole point. And that's what you bring out at these feasts. You don't just leave him out. Because it's all about him.
Amen.
It's all about him. And I know people thought I was silly and stuff, but I've done it for years. And I invite people. And we get people saved at these dinners.
Yeah.
It's a wonderful time
they
to bring your
to
family.
Jesus.
Yes.
It's a celebration that is not mixed with anything else. A lot of people don't realize. I know I was really shocked when I learned. I thought America was a God country. We are a God country, but I did not realize that we are a Greek country. Our time is based off of Greek. Our governments are based off of Greek. Our holidays are based off of Greek. So much of our culture is actually a Greek culture. And I didn't know that. And it's like, oh my goodness. You know, so I'm not the only one that is waking up to these. It's like, it's happening and has been happening. God is quickening everybody and he's bringing us back to what we're actually grafted in, to the roots of our faith, to what the early church was and what Jesus, how Jesus left us.
So the point is, all that's in the Bible.
It is all in the Bible.
It's all in the Bible. And we just went right by it. We just went, well, we don't understand that. And that's not us. That was this. This is now and that was then. And that doesn't apply. But when you look and you see that each one of these feasts are pointing to something majorly significant in the life of Yeshua, and even will tell us when we can look for his return. They all point to future things or shadow pictures of good things to come.
Yes, types and shadows.
We're getting ready to, on next week's broadcast, we're going to start with the Passover, because if we go back to the original Christians, when Jesus was on the earth, the Jewish people had these feasts that were pointing to who the Messiah was.
Yes.
And they did not see who the Messiah was. And if you read the scriptures, God actually had a plan for that. There was a purpose that they
yes.
didn't see it.
Yes.
But it was right there in front of their face. So Jesus, his first coming, he fulfilled those spring feasts. So as we study that and you learn that and you see how he did, it only makes sense that his second coming is going to fulfill those fall feasts. And so we have it right in front of our face. And it's been hidden to a lot of us, especially here in America. It's been hidden just like it was to the Jewish people and the Pharisees and all that right before him. But God is saying, no. Jesus says, these are my people. I give them this word. It's not hidden from them. It's not going to be hidden from them. I'm going to reveal so that they are ready, so that they're ready.
And we have things we have to be ready for.
Exactly. And the feast help us find those out. Mm-hmm. It's really cool. So we're getting ready to wrap this up. We got about 5 more minutes. Another scripture that people use to say that we don't have to do the feast is Romans 14:5, where it says, one man considers one day more sacred than another. Another man considers every day alike. Each one should be fully convinced in his own mind. And I've heard people say, well, you know, then as long as I don't know anything about the feast and I'm fully convinced that what I'm doing to celebrate God is good enough, then that scripture covers it. So Sharon, you want to read what our commentary
has
to say?
I would if I could see what it said. Some Christians assume that Paul is referring to the Sabbath and feast in this passage, but the Sabbath is never explicitly mentioned anywhere in the book of Romans. Since the text is unclear on the type of the day being addressed in the passage, it is not necessary to conclude Paul must be referring to the Sabbath or the feast. Furthermore, the context of this verse is in regard to opinions are disputable matters, according to Romans 14:1. Surely in scriptures, the Sabbath and the feast are never regarded as merely a matter of opinion. So what exactly is Paul talking about when he says that we must be fully convinced in our own mind when it comes to the sacred days?
And Romans 14:1, Jerry, your turn to that. So what does Paul say in Romans 14?
Receive 14:1? One who is weak in the faith, but not to disputes over doubtful things.
Yeah.
For one believes he may eat all things, but he who is weak eats only vegetables.
Yeah.
The vegetarians are weak.
You know? No, but you want to know something that I discovered about that is kind of crazy? And Sharon, you and I were talking about this. We only got a couple of minutes, but we are going into a time of strong spiritual warfare. And a doctor that is a strong Christian has done a study of Christians who battle spiritual warfare a lot and has discovered that our physical bodies get depleted of animal protein when we enter spiritual warfare. And that's why God in the Old Testament, he has planned for everything. That's why he tells the Levites, because they were the ones who entered the spiritual warfare for us, he tells them to eat the meat.
And the meat is always provided for them.
And the meat was always provided for them. They were guaranteed to have the meat. And so that it's kind of funny that now we're living in a time where they're trying to limit our meat. They're trying to take the cows and all that stuff away.
Yeah.
Because they want to, and this isn't a conspiracy theory thing, but you know, without animal protein, we are physically weak to withstand spiritual warfare for very long. So it's so funny that it would talk about, again, it was talking about the different, religious faith. Our time is just about up, so we're going to have to wrap this up. Jerry, can you read this part? The opinions over which days to hold sacred?
So the opinions over which days to hold sacred could have had to do with fast days, which would seem to fit better with the context. In either case, it's clear that this passage cannot be used to support the idea that the Sabbath and feasts are no longer important.
That's because in their history, Jewish rabbis had established a lot of sacred days that they were told to fast and to not eat that are not in the actual scriptures. They are Jewish
tradition. Their tradition just was like, to fast every Tuesday and Thursday.
I think the Catholics have a specific tradition where they fast, you know, as a denomination, and that's a Catholic thing. I'm not
and
really
they
sure.
eat fish on Friday.
And they eat fish on Friday, you know, and I'm not
there's
not
a reason for that
it.
Too.
Yeah, but you know, it's like some of these things are tradition, and that's what he was saying. So you ladies have something you want to add, listeners, if you have questions about this, be sure that you shoot us an email or just go back and rewatch on the YouTube video and make a comment, and we'll try to reply to the comments. But ladies, do you want to add anything before we close?
Well, I think, you know, we're just warming up, and we probably could have just taken just the scriptures and given our viewpoints without whatever we have in this book. But the point is that these are biblical feasts that are laid out by God. These are not the feast of the Jews. These are the feast of Yahweh. They're the feast of God. And he ordained the Sabbath from creation. That was even before he gave the law to the Hebrews. And so these things are biblical that we have just glazed over. And when you start making them part of your life, it enhances your life extremely.
It does.
Your faith.
Yes. Well, the thing I wanted to say was we were talking about how a lot of people just started getting this revelation maybe 10 years ago. And that's when the Lord first spoke to me about going to Israel. And while I was there, I learned so much about the Passover meal, the Seder, mm-hmm. and Shabbat, just having the Shabbat, you know, on Friday night, I began to learn these things. And this was not something that I ever desired I loved Israel, but this is something that God poured into me, and he will pour it into you. If you have a desire to know, he will see to it that you get to where you will learn. And that's why I think these broadcasts are so important, and how God brought us three together. Bonnie's always talking about how different we are. I don't think we're that different, but we've been brought up differently and have learned different things over the years. But God is bringing people together. Bonnie's favorite word is unity, but he really is. He is unifying. Have you noticed it? And things are happening that the Bible says will happen, and that Jesus prophesies about. In John 17, we're becoming one man. That was his goal. That was his prayer to his Father, that we would be one new man. Paul talked about
it. In the book of Ephesians.
And that's part of what we're doing here. Yep. So we're glad that you listen, and are you going to close us out, Miss Bonnie?
Yes. So yes, thank you. That is what this Grafted In is all about. It's not all about stressing our views onto any of the listeners. It's just sharing the Word of God.
Trying to look and see what it really says.
What it really says and how we can all apply it, even though we are all on different walks. So be sure to tune in next week. Next week, we're going to start with the actual feast, and you're going to learn some amazing things about these feasts that is going to really spark your interest. And I know for me, it made me think, why haven't I been doing these? This is amazing. So until next week, we all say to you, God's perfect will and peace in one word.
Shalom. Shalom.